right, for our next session, we have accelerating climate action through partnerships and geodata. We would have three speakers for this round. We have Anna Williams, which is Europe, Middle East, and Africa's lead for the Google Environmental Insight Explorer. Then we have Lisa, that is the e-mobility partnership lead at Google. And then, last but not least, we have Ailin, Huang, which is the head of sustainability at Tier Mobility. Please put your hands together and receive them on stage. Welcome on stage. Welcome to the solution stage. So whenever you're ready, take it away.
Hi, I'm Anna Williams. As mentioned, I work at Google, and at Google, I lead our efforts for a product called Environmental Insights Explore for Europe, Middle East, and Africa. And joined by Lisa, we are really thrilled to be speaking to you today about this topic. Let's see here. Yeah, at Google, sustainability, you may have heard some of our other Google colleagues speaking earlier. At Google, sustainability has really been in our DNA since our inception. By the end of our first decade in 2007, we were entirely carbon neutral in our operations. And in 2020, we announced our third decade of climate actions, which this was our most ambitious decade yet. And we had two major goals. The first is to achieve net zero emissions across our operations and value chain by 2030. And a key enabler in achieving this is to operate on 24/7 carbon-free energy by 2030. And our ambitious 10-year strategy for carbon goes far beyond our own operations. So we've structured our work at Google around sustainability into three pillars. The first is our work at Google. So it really starts with us in ensuring that our operations are sustainable, but that's also the best place for us to start in order to learn, iterate, and establish best practices. Our second pillar is supporting our partners. We are very committed to sharing learnings and best practices with our partners. And finally, third is enabling everyone. So ensuring that we are building products and solutions that help everyone make more sustainable choices every day. Today, our discussion is going to focus on the two of these pillars, supporting partners and enabling everyone. And I'm going to start with the product that I work on, which is called Environmental Insights Explore. In 2020, we made an ambitious commitment, which was to help over 500 cities and local governments reduce 1 gigaton of carbon emissions annually by 2030 and beyond. And this really starts with cities. Cities are responsible for 70% of the world's carbon emissions. And many of them, about 80% of cities, are unable to make progress on their climate commitments due to lack of availability of data and insights that they need in order to make progress on their climate commitments. And that's really why we built the product that's called Environmental Insights Explorer, or EIE. EIE uses exclusive data and modeling sources in a freely available platform to help cities and local governments measure their emission sources, run analyses, and identify strategies for reducing their emissions, really creating a foundation for effective climate action. The insights that are provided by EIE come from Google's geographical data. This is really the core of this product. And while most of you think about Google Maps, probably using Google Maps for getting from point A to point B, Google Maps also provides us with incredible insights that can really inform, when aggregated to a city scale, effective climate action for cities. And this helps cities across many stages of climate action. It's a very complex process, starting with planning, starting with measuring their baseline emissions, then planning interventions for taking action and reducing those emissions, and then monitoring those emissions over time. Within EIE, we have data across a number of sources. These key areas include providing building emissions, transportation emissions, rooftop solar potential, as well as new data pilots, including tree canopy data and air quality data. I'll dive a bit deeper into each of these data sections to give you a little bit more information about how we're actually calculating these emissions for cities. For buildings emissions, Google Maps data can estimate how much energy buildings use and the resulting emissions. When we provide cities with building emissions, we calculate within a city boundary the total emissions for residential and non-residential buildings, so cities can get an understanding of the percentage of emissions that are coming from buildings and then take action. Second is transportation emissions. So here, when you're perhaps using Google Maps on your phone, we're looking at trips data. We're aggregating that to a city scale, anonymized and aggregated, in order to understand the total trips that are taking place within a city boundary. And then we're able to infer how people are traveling to give cities an understanding of the different modes of transportation that are being utilized in a city. For example, if you're in a car on a motorway going 60 miles an hour, it's pretty easy to understand that someone is in a passenger vehicle. If you're on a trip within a city boundary making multiple stops, we can infer that you might be on a bus. So this is really effective data because we're providing cities with very granular insights so they can understand what percentage of their trips from within the city are coming from cars, what are coming from bikes, what are coming from walking trips, so they can understand their baseline emissions and then take action to try to reduce or increase different modes of transportation. You may wonder how we actually understand how this data compares to other data sources out there. We have found that our data has very high correlation with existing collection models. So we validate our data against ground truth data, perhaps with cities. So whatever sources of data that cities are using with various ways that they're collecting it, we compare it against that data, compare it against partner data to ensure that our data is aligned with cities' historical data. The third area is providing rooftop solar potential data for cities. Depending on a city's weather patterns and building types, they have various degrees of the potential emissions reduction that will come from implementing solar potential. So with the data we provide, cities are under to stand if transitioning to solar is actually a viable solution for their city. In addition to those data sources, we're piloting some new data sources that are very interesting. The first is tree canopy. As our understanding of nature-based solutions as viable options for reducing carbon emissions become more prevalent, we develop tree canopies so that cities can understand what their current coverage of trees are within their city and also understand and use it to inform their tree planting efforts within the city. And then the final source of data is air quality. For this data, we actually use a Google Street View car and drive it across a city for a prolonged period of time, and the vehicle is equipped with air sensors to help us understand and map street-level air quality for a city. Air quality can actually vary up to 800% depending on the street, so having an understanding of air quality and how it varies throughout the city can really help them develop interventions for the future. Right now, we have data for over 40,000 cities and regions, providing cities with the data that they need in order to, again, understand what their emissions are and take action to reduce them. One example that I'd love to share, just to help you understand how this data is taken into action with cities, is in Dublin, Ireland. So in Dublin, they have a target of increasing bike trips by 20% by the year 2025. And they use EIE data to monitor it over time to ensure they're hitting this target. Finally, another way in which we support cities is with funding. This means we have recently launched a $7 million grant to ICLEI Europe, which provides cities with the funding that they need in order to build programs to help them reduce emissions within their cities. Thank you, and with that, I'm going to pass it over to Lisa, who is going to speak more about consumer programs.
Thank you. Can you? Well, thank you all for being here. I know it's Friday, it's late, it's warm, so I really appreciate you sitting here listening to us. I'd like to bring a different perspective into this whole session we're having here today, and this is the consumer perspective. So I'd like to start off what Google Maps actually does. So Google Maps, as Google Maps, we help users to navigate and explore the real world. And we do that by making it safer, easier, and also more sustainable for everyone. I'd like to put it in two simple steps. We first provide information for our users to find better trips, but then we also build the tools to enable them to make more sustainable choices over time. And every sustainable choice our users do help to reduce CO2 emissions. And this also supports cities with their sustainability goals. So speaking about cities first, there are still 9% of overall global emissions caused by passenger vehicles on the road. And cities have really ambitious plans to reduce that number as much as possible. First, they try to have less vehicles on the road, privately owned. Then they encourage people to travel more actively. And thirdly, they empower people to use more public transportation. We, as Google Maps, provide those tools to the cities to enable them to put this plan into action. So moving cities to people. Also, a lot of our research has shown that Europe moves a bit different. We're a US company, and we learned that European people prefer non-driving modes. And the shocking number is that 8 times more people choose to walk, take the bicycle, or use public transport in European cities compared to the US. And that's huge. And this is also where we see we have to do something. So bringing these two parts together now, cities and users. So to keep it very simple, as I started off with, we want to help. We want to be most helpful, not just for the users, but also for the cities. And we do that by providing alternative travel modes to our users. One being electric vehicles with our electric vehicle charging solutions, walking, cycling navigation, as well as public transport and micromobility options. So you might have heard about what we're doing in the electric vehicle space, or you might have not, because I see some confused faces, but I'm happy to explain that a bit more. So for the electric vehicles, we help EV drivers to not just find electric charging stations, but we also route them there. And since there are already 60 million EVs on the street today, there's a lot of people we can help. And more than 200,000-300,000 of charging points which need to be organized and displayed in Europe alone. So these options are now available in more than 100 countries in our Google Automotive Service products as well as in the Google interfaces. Another example I like to bring up, and I think it's also the simplest mode of mobility, is really walking. So if we think about walking, we spend a lot of energy and time to really improve our maps on Google Maps. With the help of AI, we were able to go deeper and identify additional, more detailed information to bring into our maps interfaces, like crosswalks, like pedestrian walks, pedestrian islands, and really bringing this on the map to help people navigate sometimes in complex situations. And you would think, well, that's easy, I walk every day. But it's more for the people who need our help the most, who are the most valuable within the situations. Another one of my favorite examples is cycling and bike lanes. So last year, we have seen an uptick in our Google cycling directive of 98%, meaning people were cycling like crazy. And we took proactively steps to support this even further and make it easier than ever. So we added more than 150,000 kilometers on bike lanes to support our biking navigation feature and make it even more accessible for everyone. Another example is public transportation. So I have chosen a lot of German examples here, but we work with a lot of local transportation authorities and agencies all across Europe. And we really want to bring the transportation information on the map, starting from the schedules all the way to real-time availability. Our research has shown that especially real-time availability information in public transport drives user decision on their planning behavior. And last but not least, micromobility. Micromobility is also now visible on Google Maps interfaces, showing the micromobility option closest to you, from e-scooters to shared bikes. And this wouldn't have been possible without our 50-plus partners to scale this globally to more than 300 countries. And this especially, I'm very thankful that Ailin is joining us today from TIER to tell us a little bit more about how this type of partnerships can actually drive climate action and the impact.
Hello. Thank you, Lisa, for having us here. I was actually super amazed by all the developments that you have at Google. When I just think back, when I was a student, I actually get a bit nostalgic because there used to be only a desktop version of Google Maps. And whenever I wanted to get somewhere, I used to take a photo with my phone and then just awkwardly zoom in and out of this tiny photo. So we've come a long way. But back to what I'm here to talk about is how partnerships like the ones with Google enable us to drive climate action and our impact. Now, before I go into that, I just want to take a moment and briefly zoom out and look at the broader context of climate change and what the heck micromobility has to do with it. Because I don't know, some of you might think, oh, here's another annoying scooter company talking to us. So let's look at some numbers. Today, about 75% of carbon emissions in the urban transport sectors actually come from cars, even though cars only deliver about 50% of actual transport activity measured in kilometers. Now, what does this mean for the future when in 2050 we are expecting a growth in transport demand by a factor of 2.6? If we don't change anything about that, then the emissions in the sector are going to be off the charts. However, if the right policies and ambitious measures are being put in place, there's actually potential to reduce emissions in the urban transport sector by 80%. Now, what does this mean? What do these policies and measures encompass? You've probably know are familiar with like fuel efficiency standards or incentives to incentivize the change towards electrifying the automotive sector. But a critical part of this is actually mode shift. So shifting transport activity from current carbon intensive and polluting modes towards more sustainable modes such as public transport and micromobility. And there are some really smart people at the International Transport Forum that have done analysis and cracked some numbers on this. So according to their scenarios, if we were to achieve a sustainable and resilient transport mix by 2050, the share of active mobility, shared mobility, and public transport has to go up. And if you look at the kind of just bottom bar here, we see that that share of active and micromobility and shared mobility needs to go up to 60%. And adding public transport to that, we actually get to 75%. So basically 75% of the urban transport mix needs to consist of these sustainable modes. And that's exactly where we come in. So as we were founded with a mission to change mobility for good, to deliver a sustainable low carbon transport option, and we have grown in recent years to grown our operations to over 540 cities. And I actually can never keep track of this number because we're growing so fast. And we have now over 300,000 vehicles in our fleet, spanning e-scooters, but also e-bikes, mechanical bikes, and e-mopeds to serve different distances and different use cases. What's more is that TIER is also the most integrated mobility operator in Europe. We have, over the last few years, and this is why partnerships are so crucial, we have built partnerships with public transport operators and also integrated with mobility as a service providers. Through our partnership with Google, we have already completed integrations across 69 cities, and this is really helping us expand our reach. But also, the way we see our partnerships with our public transport and mass partners is to rethink urban transport in a more holistic way and to create a more interconnected transport system. Now, what does it take to achieve that? So when we talk about an interconnected transport system, we're looking at integration across different levels. So at a digital level, as we see with Google Maps, we can have integrated journey planning and ticketing. On a physical level, there's integration through mobility hubs that enable the accessibility and connectivity to public transport, for instance. On a commercial level, we have bundled pricing and discounts, for instance, with people who have public transport tickets. And on a societal level, we're looking at, in the long run, to develop dynamic user incentives to nudge people towards using greener transport modes. So it's really clear that partnerships are critical to drive our impact. So let's look at how exactly that happens. And there are three areas or three aspects of climate action and impact from the micromobility side that I would like to go into. First of all, is replacing car rides. The second aspect is complementing public transport. And the third aspect is enabling innovation through data insights. So first of all, replacing cars. We have found in recent studies that about 40% of car rides are replaceable. So there are 40% of people who can consider their car rides to be replaceable with alternative transport modes. And we here have, through different modes, we have actually different modes serve different distances and different use cases. In our research, we have seen that the people that use our e-scooters, for instance, use them for fun rides or through kind of ad hoc trips, use them to as first and last mile solutions to connect with public transport. But usually, within distances or kind of on average, they only travel 2.5 kilometers. With bikes, however, we have a slightly different use case. So we see more people integrating them into their commuting habits, but also traveling significantly longer distances, on average maybe like 5 kilometers, and e-mopeds, that's something different altogether. So that really shows that there is a need to serve the different demands of urban citizens and different use cases. Now, the premise of all this is that our services actually have to be more sustainable and emit less carbon than car rides do. And indeed, we have done some research into this as well, and the metric of comparison is the life cycle carbon emissions per passenger kilometer. So if we compare these with other modes of transport, with public transport and with cars, we see that micromobility, in particular our latest generation of e-scooters, actually emit 80% less carbon than cars. So that's a significant amount. And in fact, that even puts us on par with public transport options, making us the perfect first and last mile solution. Overall, this means that to date, we have helped avoid 45 million kilometers of car distance, and which has consequently led to emission savings of 7.5 million kilograms of CO2. Now, we don't intend to stop here, but aim to strive to continuously improve our environmental performance. We've already done a lot in this regard in the last 3 years and have reduced our emissions by about 60% through improving the lifespan of the vehicles, through greening our operations, and changing to swappable batteries. And we're setting out even further ambitious targets to reduce our emissions by another 50% in the next few years. Now, the second key area that I would like to focus on is our role in driving climate impact by complementing public transport systems. We really see ourselves as the extended arm of public transport through the first and last mile solutions. And we have worked closely with public transport operators to develop different solutions to incentivize and enable that. So in Berlin, for instance, some of you might be familiar with the Yelby app. We have integrated journey planning there. You can also book the services through the app. And in other cities like Helsinki, for instance, we also have joint ticketing and pricing bundles in the application. What we also offer in a number of German cities, for instance, are discounts for users of public transport who, for instance, have an annual pass. They can access our services at a discounted rate, and that actually has had a tremendous impact in terms of uptake in both directions, so of micromobility of our riders for public transport, but also the other way around. And we actually see this already having a significant impact. So in our recent mobility habits survey, we found that about 1 in 4 of our riders regularly use our services to connect with public transport options, and about 50% already use it occasionally. And this is something that we see improving also over time. Now, the final area through which we're enabling climate action is to drive innovation through data insights. Similar to what Anna and Lisa were talking about for Google, I would like to think we're probably not as advanced as you are in that aspect, but as you can imagine, through the IoT module and the different sensors in every vehicle, we're collecting a lot of vehicle usage and different types of mobility data. And those are data that we are already making available to cities and that they can use to then better understand mobility behavior, what the needs are in the city. Just to give one example, you see here on the map on the bottom right, sorry, it's a little bit small, this is analysis and insights that we have developed for the city of Oslo. So these show these show journeys that have started and ended in close proximity to public transport stations and help the city to infer where there are specific areas or where the biggest demand are for public transport connectivity and also the biggest potential for intermodal travel. Yeah, I think that's all from me, but I would just like to say and on a note that there's a tremendous potential for micromobility to contribute to climate action. And partnerships like the ones we have with Google are a critical element to enable that. So with that, I'll just like to hand back over to Lisa.
Well, thank you. Thanks for clapping. You're cutting us two slides short, but I think let's repeat what Ailin just said. So I just want to highlight that accelerate climate action. We really need collaboration with cities, with partners, to make it easier, cheaper, and more efficient for everyone to make more sustainable choices. And I don't think we can do this alone, so let's do it together. Thank you now, officially.
Okay, thank you very much to each and every single one of you presenting. This time we're doing things a bit different. We're gonna spice things up. I wanna start with Anna. Anna, right. What are the challenges Google faces in creating access to technology for all, especially in developing countries?
Yeah, it's a great question. I'm going to speak to it through the lens of the product that I work on, again, Environmental Insights Explorer, which the goal is providing cities with the data and insights that they need in order to understand their emissions across sources and use that data in order to take action to reduce emissions. The Environmental Insights Explorer, again, as I mentioned, we have data for about 40,000 cities and regions around the world. The good news is that also includes data for about 6,000 cities in Africa, 17,000 cities in Asia, and 9,000 cities in South America. The catch is that providing the data is just really the first step, and we're really cognizant of that. For cities, getting a comprehensive view of their emissions is really, really hard. I can't overestimate that enough. If you think about the city that you live in, think about the people that are making decisions and trying to come up with interventions in order to reduce the emissions in your city. Emissions are coming from transportation, from buildings, from waste. It's really challenging to calculate that, let alone then to measure that every year in order to understand how you're trending. So even when cities do implement an intervention, they need to track to make sure that they're on track, that they're actually achieving their goals. So back to the question, what are the challenges? I think, again, the first step we've accomplished, which is just having the data. I would say the challenges are really having a local context for that data. So really understanding the markets where we're rolling out data, understanding what are the nuances to transportation in your region. In Africa, for example, there's a lot of transportation that is called informal transportation. It's not a formal public transportation system where we might have data for. So we just need to take into account local context to really ensure that our data resonates with the region. Another part of the puzzle is funding. So data is one piece, funding is another piece. And as I mentioned, we have the Action Fund where Google has contributed about 7 million euros through this action fund to fund NGOs, civil society organizations to help support programs to help these cities. So I would say there are a number of challenges that we're very cognizant of. Where we're starting with is providing global data to help cities with that data and insights that they need. But we know that there is a lot of work ahead of us in order to really make a lot of progress with this issue.
Thank you, Anna.
You're welcome.
And I go to Lisa. I have a question for you too. So, because I saw that you've mentioned that you're working with 50 plus micromobility partners already. And is there any way to be added as a new partner? I think that might be interesting for people in the audience.
Good question. Actually, yeah. So we really want to make this a scale. So you have the option to go on our support site to sign up if you're a micromobility partner and services to Google Maps as well.
Okay. Thank you. And then, even though it's not a priority for cities, do you also support car drivers?
even better question. Actually, we do. So we were talking a lot about cities now, but there's a lot of rural areas where you still need a car. And we have a philosophy. So we say avoid where possible to drive. Try to shift if you can within a city. But if there's no other option, we really want to improve what's there. So we're actually offering eco-friendly routing, more fuel-efficient routes for normal car drivers as well. So this is a functionality being live as well.
Okay, thank you very much. Then Ailin, you mentioned on your presentation that there's 50% of tier users already occasionally using your service in combination with public transport. What needs to be done to further drive the adoption of mobility as service, as a service and intermodal usage?
I think in one word, just more. More partnerships, but also more integration. So earlier I was talking about the integration at the different levels, at the digital, physical, commercial, and societal level. And I gave a few examples of how we're already doing this, right? But for instance, the features of like intermodal planning, integrated planning and ticketing, or the different pricing options and discounts, these are solutions that exist, but they don't exist everywhere. So if we really wanted to kind of expand that and increase that share, we really need to drive further integration and uptake of these solutions everywhere. And of course, also things that we're interested in is to, and talking about with our partners, is to see whether there can be better intermodal planning. So right now, when I open the applications, I see micromobility integrated as an option. But it's not necessarily, I cannot plan necessarily with the scooter, for instance, and public transport in like one journey, if that makes sense. And I think this is something that could really increase the convenience of using our services and also increase the uptake and intermodal travel as well. So maybe okay. We can talk about that later.
And then where do people find, so if the audience has further questions, where is TIER located today in the exhibition?
Uh-oh.
Okay, then I can ask Google.
This is actually not a business zone for us.
Right. Okay, but then where is Google located for people that have more questions? I think it's right over there, right? That's the booth.
Questions, you can visit our booth where we have plenty of folks that can help answer any questions you have.
I got you. Okay, then without further ado, it's only right. We thank you for presenting each and every single one of you. So please put your hands together and thanks them for being here, thanking them.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.